No, I thought, I was waiting your hand to go down.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God the Father, God the Son, and from God the Holy Spirit. Thanks for joining us for Westminster's worship service. So glad that you've joined us as we worship together. Before we begin today, I do want to let you know, as many of you know already, next week we are going to resume in-person worship services at 8:30 and 11. You can see our website for details about that. We've also sent out an email, or you can call the church office. We will also continue to offer an electronic or a virtual worship service. We're going to do that just a little bit different. Starting next week, we're going to live stream our 8:30 a.m. worship service. So next week on Sunday, you can tune in on our YouTube channel right at 8:30 to participate with us in our first worship service. If you prefer to worship a little bit later, as soon as that service is over, it'll be recorded, immediately posted. You can also find that on our YouTube channel. So next week, find us on our YouTube channel, live at 8:30 or recorded after that. As we continue and go into our worship service, I do want to wish you a very happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to you this Sunday morning. And again, thanks for joining us for worship. Let's worship together.
Oh, come behold the works of God, the nations at his feet. He breaks the bow and bends the spear and turns the wars to cease. Oh, mighty one of Israel, you are on our side. We walk by faith in God who burns the chariots with fire. In the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go with the Lord of all? My heart be still. Though the earth gives way, the mountains move into the sea, the nations rage, I know my God is in control. The oceans roar, you are the Lord of all, the one who calms the wind and waves and makes my heart be still. The earth gives way, the mountains move into the sea, the nations rage, I know my God is in control. Lord of hosts, you're with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Where else would we go with the Lord of hosts? You are with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go with the Lord of hosts?
People of God, will you join me in prayer? Indeed, Father, we still our hearts before you. In the midst of the storms raging around us, in the midst of the anxieties that plague our hearts, we know that you are in control. We know that you are with us. Would you help us to rest in you? Holy Spirit, throughout the service, would you help us fall more and more in love with you, to commit ourselves more and more to you alone, to Jesus alone. Father, would your name be glorified, Christ Jesus, would you be exalted, and Holy Spirit, would you edify your people. Lead us, for we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Now, people of God, I think in a lot of ways, our spiritual lives can become like a kind of love triangle. Now, what I mean by that is, here we are in love with Jesus Christ, but still flirting with the world, still tempted to love the world and the ways of the world. And so our worship service this morning, it reminds us that we are the bride of Christ, called to love Jesus Christ alone. Call to worship this morning from Isaiah 61. It reminds us of this image of our relationship with Jesus as bride and as groom. So as we read our call to worship together, wherever you are, however you're watching with us this morning, would you please stand? Would you please stand for our call to worship? Stand for the reading of God's word. And I'll read portions, and then we'll read portions of it together. Isaiah 61, verses 10 and 11. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exult in my God. Let's read together. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decks himself like a priest with a beautiful headdress, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels, for as the earth brings forth its sprouts, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to sprout up again together, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to sprout up before all the nations. Please feel free to be seated as we sing together.
Trinity. Holy
saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim fall down before thee, who wert and art and evermore shalt be. Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not see, only thou art holy, there is none beside thee, perfect in power, in love and purity.
As we come to the time in our worship service for confession, our passage for our call to confession is from Jeremiah 16, and it reminds us that sin is not new. Sin has been passed down from generation to generation. In fact, all the way back since Adam. And so we are reminded of this, that we are sinners that need to repent, just as our fathers have before us. I'm going to read our call to confession from Jeremiah 16, then pray a prayer of confession, and follow that up with some silent confession where you can confess your sins to the Lord. Now hear this call. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will silence in this place, before your eyes and in your days, the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride. And when you tell this people all these words, and they say to you, why has the Lord pronounced all this great evil against us? What is our iniquity? What is the sin that we have committed against the Lord our God? Then you shall say to them, because your fathers have forsaken me, declares the Lord, and have gone after other gods, and have served and worshipped them, and have forsaken me and not kept my law, and because you have done worse than your fathers, for behold, every one of you follows his stubborn, evil will, refusing to listen to me. Let's pray together. Father, as Jeremiah reminds the people of Israel, and as we need to be reminded today, we all follow our own stubborn will. We are all being tempted and falling prey to that temptation regularly. Father, we pray now that you would convict us of these sins, that we might see the places where we're turning away from you and breaking relationship. Father, help us not only to see those places, but to bring them to you. We ask of your forgiveness for these things. We confess these sins to you, that we might be brought back into relationship with you. Now hear the prayers of your people as they confess their sins. Amen. One of the beauties of the gospel is that although we are sinners and must confess our sins, we are also forgiven. And not just forgiven, but called the bride of Christ. We are redeemed. Now hear this assurance of pardon from Isaiah 54. Fear not, for you will not be ashamed. Be not confounded, for you will not be disgraced. For you will forget the shame of your youth and the reproach of your widowhood. You will remember no more. For your Maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. And the Holy One of Israel is your Redeemer. The God of the whole earth, he is called. For the Lord has called you like a wife deserted and grieved in spirit, like a wife of youth when she is cast off, says your God. For in a brief moment I deserted you, but with great compassion I will gather you. In overflowing anger, for a moment I hid my face from you, but with everlasting love I will have compassion on you, says the Lord your Redeemer.
Deep love of Jesus, vast unmeasured, boundless free, rolling as a mighty ocean, in its fullness over me, underneath me all the current of thy love, leading onward, leading homeward to thy glorious rest above. From shore to shore, how he loveth, ever loveth, changeth never, nevermore. How he watches o'er his loved ones, died to call them all his own. For them he intercedeth, watcheth o'er them from the throne. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, love of every love. Sweet of rest, oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, tis a heaven on earth to me, when it lifts me up to glory, for it lifts me up to thee.
The love of Jesus is an ocean vast of blessing. We've been blessed by God, haven't we? And that's why we give. We give in order to say thank you to God for all of his many blessings, and we give to remind us of all of the ways that God has blessed us. You can give to Westminster by mailing a check to the office, by giving online through our website, or by texting the word Westman PCA to the number on the screen. If you're watching on YouTube, there's also a link under the video. Will you join me in prayer as we pray and set these gifts apart? Indeed, Father, we give thanks to you for your incredible blessings, the love that you've lavished on us through Jesus Christ, your love that is a stronghold, that is a place in which we hide and can stand on. And all of the things you've given us beside, all good things come from you, which is why we give them back to you. God, we give ourselves in the offering. Father, would you be glorified in all that we say and all that we think and all that we do and with all that we have? Would you use these gifts to advance your kingdom, your glory, the fame of your name? For we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
We will rejoice.
We will rejoice.
We will rejoice.
Rejoice in the Lord.
We will rejoice in the God of our salvation. He never fails.
He never fails.
He's never weary. He gives his strength.
Gives his strength to the weak.
Those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not be weary. Will walk and faint not, will walk and not faint. They will mount up with wings as eagles, they will run and not be weary, they will walk and faint not. To wait upon the Lord will have strength. If the trees never blossom, if no fruit is on the vine,
if the fields yield no grain, if no herd is in the stall,
we will still rejoice in the Lord. We will still rejoice in the Lord.
We will still rejoice.
We will still rejoice.
We will still rejoice.
We will still rejoice. We will rejoice in the God of our salvation. For we will mount up with wings as eagles. We will run and not be weary. We will walk and faint not. Those who wait upon the Lord will have strength. We will rejoice.
We will rejoice.
We will rejoice.
We will rejoice.
Mount up with wings as eagles. We will run and not be weary. We will walk and not faint. For God is our strength. Oh,
people of God, one of the ways that God gives us strength is through prayer. Prayer is what we call a means of grace, where when we come before our God in prayer, he gives mercy and grace to us, strength in our time of need. So will you join me as we go before our Lord in prayer? Well, Father, we have seen how you have carried us and given us strength and courage through hard times. As we think back through our lives and through events in our families and In the world around us through our history, we see, God, your goodness and your strength and your care. And that gives us hope, that gives us perseverance, because we know that you will renew our strength through Jesus Christ. And so here, Father, in prayer, we pour out to you the cries of our hearts and ask that you would give us mercy, that you would give us grace, that you would give us strength to help in our time of need. We pray that, Father, for our world, for our nation, for our state, for our community, for our church, as folks begin to emerge from this time of stay-at-home orders, we begin to move back into crowds and places, and as many continue to wrestle with anxiety and concern, and Father, would you give us wisdom? Would you give us courage? We pray, God, for healing of those who are sick. We pray, God, you would rid this world of this virus. We pray, Father, that you would give wisdom to our leaders. We pray, Father, that the light of Jesus would shine forth and you would draw your people to yourself. Give us, Father, mercy and grace and strength in our time of need. And we give thanks to you, Father, for the ways we've already seen your hand at work. With Nancy Grile and her family, we give thanks to you for her niece's recovery as she's beginning to walk well again, for this hope of being able to walk maybe a year from now without a limp. With Karen Haller and her family, with her mom's successful surgery, we give thanks to you, we give praise to you, and we pray now, Father, as she goes through the recovery process for healing, for comfort. And we pray, Father, you would eradicate this cancer from her body. Would you give her strength? Would you comfort her, Father? She's had to go in and out of the hospital and be alone. Continue to strengthen her faith and comfort her family. We pray that, Father, for Steve Brown's sister, Priscilla. We grieve with her, God, as she's lost her job and now, because it was tied to her place of work, now losing her place of residence as well. Father, would you comfort her? Would you strengthen her? And would you provide? Would you provide for her another job? Would you provide for another place to live? Would you provide for the courage, the strength, the mercy, and grace she needs in her time of need? And Father, we give thanks to you. We give thanks to you with Sharon Kinney, with the birth of her granddaughter, Ruth Miriam Friend, born earlier this week. We give thanks to you. We know you love life. We pray for little Ruth, Father, that she would never know a day that she did not embrace you as her Lord and Savior. Yes, Father, that she would know her sin. Yes, Father, that she would know her need for a Savior, but never a day that she did not cling to Jesus as her Savior. And with Grandma Sharon, with grandmas all over the world, and with moms, we give thanks to you. We give thanks to you for the women in our life who have been strength for us, courage and wisdom. We give thanks to you, Father, for the memories we have. We pray, Father, for those who are grieving, those who are grieving newly the loss of their mom, those who are remembering the loss of their mom. Those, Father, who grieve because they never really had a mom. Those, Father, who long to be moms have been unable. And yet, Father, you carry us and you provide for us and you give to us. And so we give thanks to you. We give thanks to you for our moms and our grandmoms, and we give thanks to you for the women in our life who have given us courage and strength and wisdom and poured themselves into us. And now, Father, would you continue to pour into us by your Spirit as we look into your word. Lead us, Father, and hear all these things that we pray, for we ask them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. People of God, will you please turn with me in your copy of God's Word to Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19. I'm going to read for us the first 10 verses. Revelation chapter 19, beginning at verse 1, and I'll read till verse 10. when you have opened your copy of God's Word or turned to Revelation 19, verse 1. Would you please stand wherever you are? Would you please stand as I read God's Word for us? Would you stand for the reading of God's Word? Revelation chapter 19, beginning at verse 1. Hear now the word of the Lord. After this, I heard what seemed to be the loud voice of a great multitude in heaven crying out, Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God, for his judgments are true and just, for he has judged the great prostitute who corrupted the earth with her immorality and has avenged on her the blood of his saints. Once more they cried out, Hallelujah! The smoke from her goes up forever and ever. The 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God who was seated on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah. And from the throne came a voice saying, Praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. And the angel said to me, Write this, Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, These are the true words of God. Then I fell down at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, You must not do that. I'm a fellow servant with you and your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. This ends the reading of God's word. Let's pray and give thanks to him for it. Indeed, Father, we give thanks to you for your word. And we ask now, by the Holy Spirit, that you would open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to understand. Cause us, Father, here in your word to know you more, that we might love you better, and so love like you love. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Love triangles. A love triangle is this weird relationship, complexity and confusion in which two people seem to be competing for the affection of a third. And often that third person remains totally undecided on which of the two he or she wants to be with. It's a common literary device. It shows up in movies and TV shows and books and plays and songs and the like. So you have Casablanca and the Hunger Games. Or for you history fans out there, the Trojan War, right? A Midsummer Night's Dream, Les Mis. Even Harry Potter reveals a love triangle involving Snape. And the Bible seems to suggest, in a way, the people of God flirt with a love triangle. The people of God flirt with a love triangle. The people of God all throughout biblical history, as you read through your Bible, as you watch the history of God's people, they often waver between two loves, don't they? Will the people of God love Jesus, or will they love the world? Will the people of God stay loyal to Jesus, or will they love the idols of the nations around them? And when we finally get to the book of Revelation, will the people of God love Jesus, or will they fall for the seductions of the culture of the world around them? In a way, the people of God are ever flirting with a love triangle. And so, as we near the end of the book of Revelation, God gives us this vivid picture of it's a picture of two women. And these two women, they represent two rival lovers, two identities, two allegiances or loyalties. And the people of God, they're being called toward one and away from the other. The first woman, we meet her for the first time in Revelation chapter 17, 18, and then part of 19. She represents the world and the cultures of the world. She's Babylon and she's Rome and she's all the great empires and powers all throughout time and history. She's called a prostitute because she seduces the nations away from the Lord. second woman. We meet her also in Revelation 19. And then we see her again in Revelation 21 and 22. She represents the church, the true people of God. She's all of God's people throughout time and history. She's called the bride because she belongs to Jesus Christ alone. In our text before us this morning, we see these two women contrasted in this text. And so for our time together today, let's look closer at these two women. And by contrasting them next to each other, we can see clearly God's call toward one and away from the other. So this morning, we'll use our text to look closely at the prostitute and at the bride by looking at each of their motives, by looking at each of their actions, by looking at each of their end. And we'll see God calling us away from one of these women and toward the other. Well, let's begin this morning by looking at the prostitute. Now, if you've read through the book of Revelation recently, or if you've been with us in this series the past few weeks, you may remember the prostitute. She's introduced to us first in Revelation chapter 17. So in Revelation chapter 17, an angel takes the apostle John, takes him out to a wilderness, so he gets some distance here. And there he sees this attractive woman, clothed in garments of red and purple. She's decked in gold and in pearls and in all kinds of jewelry. And he learns her name is symbolically Babylon. In chapter 17, we see the world. We see the culture of the world is represented by this image of a prostitute, a temptress, if you will, a woman seducing the nations with her promises of riches and comfort and ease. Of course, in the book of Revelation, the Apostle John, he's referring to Rome, right? That's the predominant culture at the time that the Apostle John is writing this book. But she's called Babylon in part to show us that she's every culture. She represents every culture of every time period all throughout the history of the world. She is Egypt and Assyria. She's Babylon and she's Rome. She's the Far East. She's the Near East. She's Europe and North America, Western culture, and all our modern culture. She represents all the cultures, all the ways and practices and habits and rituals of every people group throughout time and history. She's the world and the ways of the world. And she hates the Lord. And she hates the Lord's people. This is her motive. So as we look closer at her motive, Revelation chapter 19, verse 2, in this celebration of the destruction of Babylon, look at the end of verse 2. The end of verse 2, Revelation chapter 19, God has avenged on her, on the prostitute, he has avenged on her the blood of his servants. At chapter 17, when we first meet Babylon the prostitute, she's got this golden goblet in her hand. And it's filled with the blood of the people of Jesus, filled with Jesus' people's blood. It's an image of her hostility toward the Lord and her hostility toward the Lord's people. She hates the Lord. She hates his people. And so also in chapter 17, we see she's an agent of the beast that comes up from the abyss, the beast that belongs to the dragon, the beast that belongs to Satan, that great enemy of God and his people. She hates the Lord, and she hates the Lord's people. So in our text in Revelation 19, 2, we see that this woman has spent her energy actively pursuing the death and the destruction of God's people. Listen, people of God, the world is not neutral. The world is not amoral, without moral value. The world has a side. The ways of the world, the culture of the world, it is hostile to the people of God. It is hostile to the ways of the Lord. This is why our Savior says, you're either for me or against me, isn't it? He says, you cannot serve two masters. Right? You can't love God and also love money. People of God, the world is not neutral. It has a side. The ways of the world are not neutral. And what we see in Revelation is that the ways of the world, the culture of the world around this, she's a prostitute who hates the Lord and hates his people. This is what drives her. And now, don't hear what I'm not saying. This doesn't mean that we withdraw from the world. This doesn't mean that we cloister ourselves. Hear me really clearly. This does not mean that we should avoid arts and entertainment and politics and the like. I'm not saying that at all. In fact, the Lord sends us out into the world, sends us out into Babylon, sends us out into the culture, kind of like secret agents, right? Or undercover police officers. And we're bringing his light to the world around us. We're snatching people from the fire as we share the good news about Jesus. We're shining his light in Babylon. But we have to have our eyes wide open. How many police dramas have you seen where the undercover cop loses his way, forgets who he is, forgets which side he's on? We've got to have our eyes wide open. We need to see the world is not neutral. The ways of the world are hostile to God. You can't love God and also be friends with the world, the Apostle James says. The prostitute, she hates the Lord. She hates his people. This is her MO. This is her motive. And her motive, it drives her actions. So let's look at her actions. Let's look at what the prostitute does. Still in verse 2, Revelation 19, verse 2. Read with me. The Lord has judged the great prostitute. Do you see where I am? Revelation 19, verse 2. The Lord has judged the great prostitute who corrupted the earth with her immorality. Again, when we first meet the prostitute, back in Revelation chapter 17, we hear that the kings of the earth, they have committed sexual immorality with her. Then we hear the dwellers on the earth, they've become drunk with her sexual immorality. The prostitute, she seduces, that's what she does. It's who she is. She promises comfort and ease. She promises power and worth. She promises happiness. She promises to make all your problems go away or at least help you forget them. And with her promises and with her lies, she lures you into this fatal embrace, lures you into addiction. And because so easily we become addicted to her promises, we enter into this endless chase. Forever after, you keep chasing after the prostitute. Just one more dollar. Just one more lover. Just one more experience, one more show, one more device, one more gadget, one more whatever it is that she's offering. And pretty soon you're hooked. Chasing her dreams, chasing her kisses, chasing her empty promises. This is what she does. She seduces. She lures people to herself until they're addicted and they keep coming back to her over and over and over and over again. It's easy to get hooked on her, isn't it? It's easy to get hooked on the prostitute. She promises all the things that we think we want. Money, influence, entertainment, relationships, just feeling happy. She promises happiness. We want happiness. But eventually all her lovers look like her. Listen, friends. Those who love the prostitute, they eventually become like the prostitute and look like the prostitute. What do they look like? Well, they chase after the things that she does. They chase after the things that she offers. Workaholics, shopaholics, addicted to sports, addicted to food, addicted to relationships, addicted to new experiences, addicted to gadgets and toys and stuff. Friends, this is how we fall in love with the prostitute. It's by chasing after all of her empty promises. It's by living for the things that she loves, the things that she offers. And it's so easy to fall for her because we like all the stuff that she's selling. I think this is a good place for us to jump down to verse 9, Revelation 19, verse 9. The angel says, write this down, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Verse 9, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Look, friends, all must choose which woman they will join, the prostitute or the church. There's no room here for love triangles. There's no room here for divided loyalties. Either you love the prostitute or you love the bride. But this isn't about a one-time decision. That's not what I'm talking about here. It's not about a prayer we say at the altar. It's not about this single moment in time when we ask Jesus to come into our heart. This is about a way of life. This is about a way of living and a way of loving. It's about heart affection and allegiance and devotion. Either you live for the prostitute and the ways and things of this world, or you live for the bride as the people of God. And so we turn and see the end of the prostitute. Revelation 19 begins with this celebration of the destruction of the prostitute. She's judged by the Lord God Almighty. Judged by the Lord because she hated the Lord and hated his people. Judged by the Lord because she seduced the people of the world away from the Lord. And so the Lord, in his justice, it destroys the culture of the world and the ways of the world. And look at verse 3. The smoke of Babylon, it goes up forever and forever. It's an image designed to show us the permanent, the final end to the ways and culture of the world. When Jesus returns, when Jesus judges his enemies and ours, they will be destroyed forever. That's it. It's a total, complete, and final destruction for the prostitute and for all who love her. It's an eternity of destruction. It's an eternity of darkness and of pain. It's an eternity for the prostitute and for all who love her. Their end is eternal darkness and eternal suffering. See, the prostitute, she hates the Lord and hates his people. That's her motive. She seduces people with her empty promises, luring them into cycles of addiction and chasing after her affections. That's her actions. But she will be destroyed forever. And that's her end. You see, the Lord calls us away from her. And the Lord calls us toward his bride. The bride of the Lamb, the church. That's the second woman in this passage. Look at verse 7. Verse 7, this loud voice comes out, says, let us rejoice, let us exult, let us give God the glory, because the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. Now, two chapters from here, when we get to Revelation chapter 21, we see the bride again. And there she's also described as a city, the New Jerusalem. It's another image for the bride, for the church. And if you keep reading in Revelation chapter 21, as it describes this bride, you hear this promise. Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them. They will be his people. God himself will be with them as their God. This is the church. This is the people of God from all time and all history gathered together at the end of time, where they will live with and reign with the Lamb, the bride and the Lamb together forever. This is the church, the collective people of God. So let's take a few moments and look a little closer at the bride. And like with the prostitute, we begin with her motive. So look at verse 5. Verse 5. A voice from the throne of God. I'm in Revelation 19, verse 5. This voice from the throne of God, it booms out, right? Praise God, all you his servants. Now look at how those servants are described. Those who fear him. The bride fears the Lord. The bride fears the Lord. Now, in the Bible, to fear the Lord is to respect him. It's to recognize his authority as the true king, as the only ruler of the universe. It's to acknowledge he alone is God. It's to agree that he has all authority and all power. You see, the fear of the Lord, it's not a fear that is afraid. Rather, it's a fear that recognizes and humbly follows. It's a respect that follows the leading one, the one who's in charge. And the fear of the Lord, it's also love. Did you notice the language used to describe the church in our text? Right, verse 7, it's a marriage. This is absolutely about love. It is about love, but not the Hollywood kind of love, not the Disney form of love, of feeling in love one day and feeling out of love the next. That's how you end up in love triangles, isn't it? No, this is about true love. True love means commitment. True love means keeping your promises. True love means loyalty and allegiance and genuine affection and trust. You see, this is a fear, this is a love that results in total devotion to the one who's loved. Did you see in the song of the great multitude at the beginning of our passage in verse 1? Do you hear what they're singing? Salvation and what? Salvation and glory and power. This is about all for Jesus. That's the song of the bride. It's to you, all for you, Lamb of God. That's the song that introduces the marriage. When you get to verse 7, Revelation 19, let us rejoice and exult in what to say and give him the glory. That's the song of the bride, delighting in her husband. All for you, Lamb of God. This is the motive of the bride. It's fear of the Lord. It's love of the Lord. It's total devotion and commitment and faithfulness to the Lord. She has been purchased by the very blood of Jesus. He has saved her from sin and from darkness and from evil and from death by giving up his own life, by dying on the cross, by being buried, by being raised to life on the third day. This is the true lover of our soul. He died and he rose for us. And so our hearts sing out, all for Jesus, all for you, Lamb of God. It's a motive that drives all of our actions, all our thoughts, all our words, all our deeds, what we do with what we have. It's all for Jesus, all for you, Lamb of God. We see that in verse 8. Look at verse 8, Revelation 19. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. I want to stop here just for a minute, because all throughout the book of Revelation, there's this dual use of this image. This image is used in two distinct ways that come together all throughout the book of Revelation. And so the people of God, all throughout the book of Revelation, they are clothed in white. And in multiple places in the book of Revelation, this white robe, it represents the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So, for example, in Revelation chapter 7, we're told the saints wash their robes in the blood of the Lamb. This is just the truth of the gospel, the truth of the good news of Jesus. We are, in our natural state, we're stained by sin, aren't we? In our natural state, we are stained by sin. Our disobedience to God, our failure to keep the word of God, it results in our souls being stained by sin. But the only way to get that stain out, the only way to wash out that stain, is to put your trust in Jesus. We have to rest in his life, in his death, in his resurrection. When we put our trust, when we put our faith, when we put our hope in Jesus Christ for salvation, our sins are taken away. We're clothed with his own righteousness. We're covered with his holiness, covered with his purity. We're given a pure, clean, bright robe to cover ourselves with. But there's this dual use of this image in the book of Revelation. You see, not only does it refer to the covering of Jesus, he has washed us with his blood. He has covered us with his righteousness. But this white robe, it also refers to our faithfulness to the Savior. It refers to our obedience to his word. And so, look at the rest of verse 8. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. This is about what we do. This is about what the bride does. And so what does the bride do? She does righteous deeds. And we got to be really careful here. It's easy for us to read here into this, our own understanding of the righteousness, of this word righteousness into the text. But in the Bible, the word is larger than holiness or purity. Sure, it includes that, but it's bigger than that. Because as you read through the Bible, this word righteousness, it typically includes this notion of faithfulness, of loyalty. Well, that makes sense here in a text talking about a bride in a prostitute, doesn't it? And actually, that understanding, it fits in with what the Apostle John has written all throughout the book of Revelation. I mean, you start at the beginning of Revelation and just begin reading through. When he gets to the section where he's writing letters to these small churches, he warns the churches. He says, stay faithful to Jesus. He says, don't get your robes dirty. Don't get seduced by Jezebel. Don't get seduced by the prostitute. Stay faithful to Jesus, the Apostle John says. That's the call here in Revelation 19. The prostitute has many lovers, but the bride stays faithful to Jesus. Stay faithful to Jesus. And it's interesting here the way our section ends, this next paragraph. If you go down to verse 10, here in verse 9, the Apostle John, he's marveling at this word from God through the angel. He bows down, he tries to worship the angel, and the angel says, don't do that, worship God. And then the angel says this, I'm a fellow servant with you and your brothers, who hold to the testimony of Jesus. What's the testimony of Jesus? It's the word of God, isn't it? The angel continues, the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Here the angel is reminding the Apostle John, here the angel is reminding us, all of Scripture leads to Jesus. It's all about Jesus. The entire word of God points to Jesus, is fulfilled in Jesus, and exalts and glorifies Jesus. And that's what the bride does. The bride exalts and glories in Jesus. This is why the Apostle Paul says in his letter to the church in Ephesus, in the book we call Ephesians, he says, the bride is washed with holy water and with the word of God. Friends, this is how we stay faithful. It's by reading and studying and meditating upon God's word. It's by doing the word of God. That's the righteous deeds of the saints. It's doing the word of God. It's by staying faithful to Jesus and keeping his word. If you love me, Jesus says, keep my commandments. This is what the bride does. She exalts and glories in Jesus by keeping his word, by staying faithful to Jesus and staying faithful to his word. And her reward, her end, it's eternity with her husband, the Lamb. It's eternity with Jesus Christ. You know, the image in Revelation 19, it already showed us this smoke from Babylon. It's going up forever and ever, smoke from the destruction of the prostitute. That's a reminder that the destruction of the prostitute, her end is total, her end is final, her end is complete destruction. But the end of the bride, we marry the Savior. We get eternity with Jesus in this world made new and whole and right again. That's what Revelation chapters 21 and 22 are all about. You see, at the end of time, Jesus will come back, Jesus will return, and he'll claim his people for himself. All those who remain faithful to him until the end, we will live with him, we will reign with him forever and ever. That's the end promise to the bride. It's eternity at home with the Lamb, with our Savior Jesus Christ. In Revelation chapter 19, we see these two women, two rival women, two rival lovers, rival loyalties, rival allegiances. The first is the prostitute. She is Babylon, she is Rome, she is every culture throughout time and history. She is the world, she is the ways of the world, and she hates the Lord. And she hates his people. She seduces people with her empty promises, luring them into cycles of addiction, chasing after her affections. But she will be destroyed in the end, forever. The second woman is the bride. She loves the Lamb because he saved her with his own death and resurrection. She fears him, she loves him, she adores him, is devoted to him, lives for his glory, all for Jesus, all for you, Lamb of God. She's faithful to him, faithful to Jesus, faithful to his word. And in the end, she will live with him in that place that he's preparing for her, the world made new and whole and right again, where they will live and reign together forever and ever. This image and revelation of these two women at the end of the book, through this picture, God is calling us away from one of these women and toward the other. He's calling us away from the prostitute and the ways of the world, and he's calling us toward the bride, calling us to his church and his people, calling us to faithfulness. So as we wrap up this morning, people of God, where are you flirting with a spiritual love triangle? Where's your heart's loyalty divided? Where are you giving your love, your heart, your affection to anything or anyone other than Jesus? Where are you flirting with rival love, rival loyalties? Get rid of the prostitute and give yourself solely to the Lamb. Will you pray with me? Father, we give thanks to you for your word and for your love for us, that you continue to call us to faithfulness, because you know our hearts are prone to wander. You know our hearts are prone toward rival loves, rival affections, rival worships. And yet in your goodness to us, you continue to wash us with holy water and with your word. So Lord Jesus, would you forgive us for where our hearts have turned away from you? Would you forgive us for where we have shared our heart with other lovers? Would you give us a singleness of heart, undivided loyalty and devotion to you alone, that we might indeed be a pure, spotless, radiant bride? We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. In our closing song, the last verse is this prayer. It says this: so Spirit, come, put strength in every stride, give grace for every hurdle, so we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful, a faithful bride. Let's sing together, O Church, Arise.
Arise and put your armor on, for the call of Christ our captain. For now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies, an army bold whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. When faced with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure, and Christ will have the price for which he died, an inheritance of nations. Arise, shine, for your light has come. Arise, shine, for the risen sun. Lift your eyes, we are his radiant bride. Arise, O church, arise. See the cross where love and mercy meet, as the Son of God is stricken. Then see his foes lie crushed beneath his feet, for the conqueror has risen.
And as a stone is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, the victory march continues till the day. Every eye and heart must see Him.
Spirit come,
strengthen every stride, give grace for every hurdle,
that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful.
As saints of old still mind the way, retelling triumphs of His grace,
we hear the calls and hunger for the day
when we stand
in glory.
Once again, I want to wish you a very happy Mother's Day and receive from the Lord now as He blesses and sends us out. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do His will, working in us that which is pleasing in His sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's sing the doxology together.